Welcome to the Code Europe in Warsaw. And we want to have a talk today about telepresence robotics with Now and Kinect. And this is why we are here. And you can see this little guy. This is the Now robot. So, okay. We have a problem. Okay, let's reload the presentation and Before we start with our talk, maybe a few words we want to introduce ourselves to you. So, Thomas. Yeah.
So, my name is Thomas Andres. I've been studying computer sciences in Munich, and after studying, I joined TNG. And in our free time, and also now in our work time, we are doing things with robotics, gesture control, and so on. We will talk about that in a minute.
Yeah, right. So my name is Martin Furch. I studied computer sciences as well, working for TNG Technology Consulting for 12 years as a software consultant. And let's go. Where it all began. So we are doing crazy projects since 4 years, I would say.
Yeah, and the first one was in 2013 when we started to control quadrocopters. But we did not want to do it in a traditional way with a smartphone
or
a controller or something like that. But we wanted to do it with bare hands. So no such thing. And we did this like this. So you can go left and right. You can go forward, backward, up, down, and you can control the yaw. And with this, people were able to control a quadrocopter within, let's say, a few minutes or something like that, and land it in an exact spot. Yeah, this was our first project. Our next one was about...
Yeah, the next one was the Terminator vision. So, I wake up at the morning and I thought, oh, maybe it's nice to see the world through the eyes of a Terminator. So why not building a hardware doing this? So we just realized some kind of AR glasses with which you can actually see the world through the eyes of a Terminator. And this is what you are seeing here in this animation. So we used an Oculus Rift. And on this Oculus Rift, we attached a 3D camera. So above this Rift. And this 3D camera was capable to identify 78 points, landmark points in the face. And additionally, we had some kind of emotion detection and heart rate measurement. So actually, you have some features Arnold Schwarzenegger had with his Terminator. So you can see it here. 78 landmark points and distance measuring and whatever you like. So this was really amazing. And then we needed to find another crazy demo. And as you can see, we get inspired by science fiction movies. So the next thing we wanted to do is to slip into the role of a robot. And we stole this idea. We were inspired by the movie Project Avatar from James Cameron. Here you can see Captain Jack Sully, and he's disabled. He's not able to walk anymore. And but his consciousness gets just transferred with a special system into this tall blue little guy. It's a Navi. It's a native tribe living on the moon Pandora. And he slipped into the role of this Navi. And he can hear everything from the perspective. He can listen to the environment from the perspective of this guy. He can feel and he's some kind able to walk as well. So our idea was, yeah, we want something comparable. We want to slip into a role of something else and to see the world from a different perspective, like a little child. And this brings us to Project Avatar, and this is what we want to talk about. So how to do such a project? For us, it was totally clear that we need some hardware. For example, for us, it was clear we want a 3D camera because you don't want to remote control a humanoid robot with joysticks or keyboards. That's nearly impossible to do. So a 3D camera recording our skeleton, and this data gets transferred to a humanoid robot. In this case, it's the Now, this little blue guy here on the stage. And additionally, we wanted to see everything from the perspective of the robot and then it was clear that we have to use a head-mounted display, in this case, an Oculus Rift. So, but now, a few words to TNG Technology Consulting.
Yeah, a few words to our team, actually. Mm. So we were not the only ones building this. So you can see everybody who was working on this project during its invention. So every project that we start starts at a so-called winter retreat. This is one day where we go into the Alps. And the special thing about it is we try to implement something that is working within the first day. So after the first day, there should be a working prototype. And then we refine it at the so-called tech days and try to make it better. So if you see, the complete installation was not done in one day. But it took a lot of time. But the first prototype was really built in one day.
Yeah. So we are allowed to use 10% of our working time to work on such projects. So this is the idea behind that. And yes, we are hiring. So if you have plans to come to Munich, Germany, feel free. Okay, so now to the agenda.
What are we talking about today? First, we're going to give an introduction into the terms we are talking about. Then we will have a short look into the history of telepresence and telerobotics. And then we will go into code and technology. That's where we do some live coding. We will also do a live demonstration, and we will have a look at all the technologies that were used here. The fields of application will be the next thing, and then a conclusion. That's
okay. So let's start with the introduction. So telepresence robotics. Why do we do telepresence robotics? We want to overcome human barriers. There are different barriers existing. In this painting, you can see some natives. They are using smoke signals, and they want to overcome the barrier of communication over long distances. Yeah. So if there are some enemies, you can warn other tribes that there are enemies coming by. There are other barriers as well to overcome. For example, if it comes to dangerous places. So let's imagine a power plant where a disaster beyond all expectations happened. It's better to send a robot instead of human beings to clear up the situation, for example. And other barriers are, for example, scale and matter. So scale, for example, when it comes to surgery, a surgeon is able to walk with a make a surgery with a precision of centimeters or millimeters using telepresence surgery robots. You can work with a precision of micrometers, maybe less.
So when it comes to telepresence robotics, we have two terms that we talk about. The first one is teleoperation. So teleoperation just means controlling remotely a mechanical system. So in this case, we see a robot. This is the Carpio robot from the DFKI. And this robot is controlled using this exoskeleton, which you see in the background. So this is a practical application of teleoperation. The second term we want to talk about is telepresence. So telepresence means that you feel like you are somewhere else. So we have this classical telepresence system. If you have seen Big Bang Theory, you know one of these. These normally consist of microphones, of display, of loudspeakers, and
cameras,
of course. Yeah, so you can see the world from the perspective of this robot, and the world can see you as well. And that's why you feel like you are somewhere else. And if you combine that, you have telepresence robotics.
Right. So when you have a look into the Springer Book of Robotics, there is this drawing about multimodal telepresence, and as Thomas already said, there are two sides. So we have the operator side and the remote side. On the operator side, the human operator is generating position data, forces, or something like that. This data gets transferred over a communication channel by your choice. And then this position data, these forces, they get transferred to the teleoperator. And this teleoperator can manipulate the environment on the remote side. And using sensors, you can, of course, identify those changes on the remote side And this gets transferred back over the feedback channel. And using special displays, you can make them seeable or you can hear them. So microphones, for example, you need loudspeakers, or a haptic display, for example, force feedback joysticks, and so on and so on. So this is the theoretically how it looks like. And this is actually what we have done with our project, and we want to show you the realization of that after the history.
Yeah, and when it comes to history, the first real application of teleoperation is this one. So Ralf Moscher from General Electric, we see him here in the year 1958. So this is a really old technology that we are talking about. And this is the controller part of a bigger system. So you can see here, he has these massive devices on his hands. And all he is doing with that is he is controlling a robot over this distance. And here you can see the robot, and he can do this to, yeah, he is able to scare away kids. You can see that in the background. But he can also spin a hula hoop wheel with enough precision with this device. And it was initially thought the field of application of this device was to handle dangerous substances, so to fill one Erlenmeyer tube into another, or something like that.
Yeah. So to want to overcome the barrier of dangerousness. Okay. 1986, it was Chernobyl. There was a disaster beyond all expectations, and what you can read here, or what you can see, is those engineers walking over the roof. And on this roof, there are 500 Röntgens. This means it's around about 4.66 sieverts. And this means if you are there for a few seconds or minutes, you will most likely die within the next 30 days. And yeah.
Unfortunately, we have a problem with the video.
Yeah, it's the new Firefox, so the videos are stopping. We don't know why, but it's a bug, not a feature. Okay, so they just removed all the trash from the roof. This was the idea behind that. And they sent a moon rover onto the roof, which was from the GDR. And unfortunately, so this was a telepresence idea there. The camera was attached to the moon rover. To put away the trash, but it stopped working within minutes because the radiation on the roof was so high that the power circuits and everything were destroyed. So no chance to overcome the barrier of dangerousness. And we don't overcome the barrier to show the video. That's a real pity. Okay, another example of teleoperation is the Lindbergh operation, which happened in 2001. And from Europe, Lindbergh, Dr. Jacques Marusco, made a surgery on the hips of an old woman who was based in New York. And they were able to control the Taylor robot on the other side. And this makes me nervous that the video is not playing. Anyway. And the huge challenge was that they only had a data connection of 10 megabits. So, but the good news is she survived, and it was successful. Yeah.
Okay.
And now we want to come to the Now robot.
Yeah. So let's talk about the robot itself. So as you can see, the robot is a humanoid robot. So it's based on the physiology of a human, and it's 50 centimeters in height. It is built by SoftBank Robotics, which was Aldebaran before that, but Aldebaran was bought by SoftBank Robotics in 2016. And yeah, the main feature of the robot is its cuteness, actually. but it did not always look that cute. So if you see the first pictures from the year 2005 here, yeah, it's just a few cables, just a few servers, just a bit of structure. And over time, you see that it evolved, and we got more and more. It got the shape it has today, until in the year 2008, the first real version, the first release candidate, came out. And from there on, it did not change that much from a physical point of view. But of course, computing power changed. So what we have here is the fifth generation from the year 2004. 14.
So let's have a look to the main features of the now. So I will come to the other side of the stage. So beside being acute, we have different other features here. So we have tactical haptic sensors on the head. You can use them as a button. We have two cameras in the now's head. They are vertical aligned, right? You can make your data connection using Wi-Fi or Ethernet. There is a battery included, so you can run without cables for, let's say, 4 hours. It depends on the tasks the now is doing. We have, what was the name for that? The sonars here. The sonars, there are here the sensors, so you can just identify objects which are moving in front of you or something like that. And what else did I miss to say? Speakers, of course, so that we can communicate with the now robot. And microphones, that's important. We have 4 microphones in the now set. This is so that 4 microphones so that we can identify the source of the sounds, the audio signals, where they come from. Yeah.
Yeah, you can connect him using Ethernet and Wi-Fi, as already said. And one important thing is the vertical alignment, and this is its normal use case is RoboCup. So you play soccer with this robot. There's it has its own league in the RoboCup, and yeah, you have to look downwards to see the ball rolling over the floor.
Yeah. So just go to YouTube, type in RoboCup, and you will see many videos of robots falling down. Okay.
Yeah.
Apropos falling down, this brings us to predefined poses.
Let's talk about falling down. there are some predefined poses for the robot. You see him now. He has the crouch position, which is this one, but there are more to that. And the predefined poses are special in a case that the robot can go from wherever, whatever pose he is currently taking into this position. So there are macros defined so that he can get, for example, from the stand position, so this one, to the crouch position, to the sit position, and so on and so on. So he can do this by himself. You don't have to put him into this pose. And this is especially important when we talk about the not so voluntarily taken positions like lying back or lying belly. Of course, he can go there voluntarily, but normally he just falls down. And then he can put himself up again and stand up again.
Yeah, now let's have a look to the skeleton of the now. As we already told you, it's a humanoid robot. What does it mean? That the whole skeleton is somehow inspired by the human skeleton. So if you have a look to the hips, for example, you have 3 degrees of freedom, yes? And if you have a look to the elbow, yeah, we have only 1 degree of freedom. It's not really true for the now robot because he has 2 degrees of freedom, you know, so that he can do this movement, yeah? Okay, so what you can see here, these are the names of the so-called joints, yeah? It's a joint. And these are the names, and you can read all those stuff in the documentation. You need that if you want to control the joints freely. And this is what we want to talk about right now, because we want to make a short live coding session with you.
Yeah, and for that, I'll explain what we want to do. So currently, the robot is sitting in this crouch position, like he is now. And what we want to do is we want to go to this position.
Yeah, so this position. You have 20 seconds to comply. Okay, which movie? RoboCop. Right, perfect, awesome.
RoboCop.
I said that in the wrong dialect. Okay, so.
Okay. And for this, we need a few degrees of freedom now. So this is also taken from the documentation, so you can see the different joints again and the name of the joints. But you can also see the angles that these joints can take. You can then translate this to radians, and this is the value that you put into the API in the end. So if we want to do this movement, we need 3 joints in total. First of all, we need the shoulder pitch, so this. Then we need the shoulder roll as well, so this one, and we need the elbow roll. And with that we can go from here to here. And of course we need this for both hands. Okay, so that's enough for the preparation.
Okay, so now it's a test, the first time we let the audience choose which language you want to see. So, you can decide between Java or Python. Who is for Java? Okay. Who's for Python? Okay, that's clear.
That's more.
Okay. I said that. It's good if we ask the audience. Okay, so let's go to Python.
Yeah, let's have a look at Python. So, here you have the preparation. It's not much to do. The most important thing is this one, so the Now Key SDK, which you can download from the Aldebaran website or SoftBank website right now. And the Now Key SDK is available for many languages, so Java and Python are not the only ones. You can also use it with JavaScript, C++, and there was a C# API, but it was discontinued, so this is no longer supported. Okay, what you have to do first is we need the IP address of the Now, so this is the one he gets via DHCP or whatever when you connect him to the wireless networks or if you connect him via Ethernet. And then we need a port, which is by standard means 9559. And if we have that, we can then define so-called proxies. So proxies are things that the robot does remotely. We have multiple proxies. So the first one is the AL text-to-speech. So this makes the robot talk. Then we have the audio player, so you can also play WAV files or something like that. We have the robot posture proxy, which means that you can take these predefined poses. And the most important for our live coding session right now is the AL motion proxy. And this proxy is used for controlling the joints freely. Okay. Yeah, so let's have a blank sheet right now, and now we're gonna do some live coding. Yeah, Martin is already demonstrating that this is really live coding, and not
it's really live coding.
Okay, so what we will do first is we need to define all the joints that we want to use. So we define an array, and within this array we use the three joints that we identified before. So it was the shoulder roll, it was the shoulder pitch, and it was the elbow roll. And we need this as well for the right hands, so we do the same for the right hands, and the only difference here is that it's R instead of L. And then we need the values of these joints, so we define another array and define the values in the same order as the joints appeared before. So first value, left shoulder roll should go to position 2.0, left elbow roll to -1.5, and so on and so on. And we do this again for the right hands. In this case, we have some asymmetry, some symmetry, and that's why some values are inverted. And next, so this is the last point, is we need to call the AL motion proxy, and with this motion proxy we call set angles, and the set angles method is taking as a first parameter the joints, then the angle values, and as a third parameter the speed in which the robot should take this position. So 0.5 is half the full speed, 0.0 would be no speed, 1 would be the fastest speed that is available. And we do this for the right hand as well. We can do this at the same time because these methods are asynchronous. So if you just do both, then it will do this at the same time. Okay. Yeah. We use the speech proxy, okay? And say something. And now let's try
okay,
it.
Okay, let's try it. So it's a live demo. We hope everything works fine. So execute. Awesome. Works. Okay, so now we have our final position, so you have 20 seconds to comply. And now there is one very important thing. Now there is voltage on the motors, so this means, you know, it's stiff. Yeah, there is a stiffness. And if we remain this robot right now for the rest of the talk, then he starts to complain, oh, my motors are getting too hot. Yeah, so it's a good idea to call the command rest. So the voltage of the motors will get removed, and the stiffness then is zero. So let's motion proxy dot rest. Sorry?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Everything's good.
And let's try it again.
You have 20 seconds to confirm.
So now it's going back into rest mode. And now the stiffness is zero. And he will not start to complain that his motors are getting too hot. Okay.
Okay.
So now we learned how to program the now robot with Python. The good news is that the difference between Python and Java is not that much. So if you understand this code, you will totally will be fine with Java as well, or whatever. What do you need?
I need the HDMI cable.
You need the HDMI cable because of what? Because we have the live demo right now. Hey, what is he doing? Stop that. Okay, so now we want to show you the full demo of our Tele Presents project. Yeah, okay.
Okay, let's see.
So Thomas will now slip into the role of the now robot.
Do we have a signal?
Yeah, do we have a signal?
No signal? No, that's a pity.
Ah, there it is. There awesome.
Okay.
So, Thomas, show us the Oculus Rift. To the audience, please. So Thomas has an Oculus Rift in his hands, and we attach two RGB cameras. The reason behind that is that we want to see like normal, like usual. Okay. So Thomas, so please put on the Oculus Rift. We have a Kinect camera in our flight case. Thomas, can you have a look to the Kinect, please? Maybe you can go to the Kinect directly so that we can film it for the audience. Yeah, awesome. Yeah, so this is the Kinect camera. You can see those infrared LEDs here. And so Thomas, now go back, please. And Thomas can now take over the robot using a circle gesture with the left arm clockwise. So please, Thomas, do that. And then his consciousness gets transferred into the now. So now, oh no?
We have some technical problems.
Okay, so now we make live bug fixing. This is planned, of course, within our talk.
So also that the mouse is not working.
The mouse is not working, okay.
Working again.
Okay. So you see, it's really live, yeah? there is nothing prepared, no. Okay.
I am now visualized.
Oh, that's good. So Thomas, try again. Mm-hmm. So. Awesome. So now please look around. Yeah. Maybe you can wink to the audience. Mm-hmm. Okay. Awesome. Awesome. Yeah, maybe I can give you something in your hands. So just, yeah. And now close your hands. I give it to you the right hand. Okay. Close it. Close it. Okay. Now throw it away. You don't like it. Okay. Something like that. And yeah. Okay. You were lost. But please take over the control again. And now we want to walk. Thomas. Okay, stop that. Okay, so an important thing is what we are using here is a walking macro. The reason behind that is we don't use the movements of the legs of Thomas directly because he will fall over. When we are using the built-in walking macro, there is a fall manager and he holds the balance automatically. So this is the reason why we don't use it, why we don't directly mirror this leg data to the now robot. Okay, so then we have another thing. When things are going wrong, should I take out? Okay, so let's stop it. Okay, so this is our IoT button. Whenever something goes wrong, you just press it and it's fine.
It's always nice getting that past airport security.
Yes. Okay, and now after this demo, thank you. And now after this demo, we want to show you how we realized that project. As you already recognized, some guys in Dutch, they told us it's tech porn because we combine so many technology things in there. So there is something wrong with the... no?
There's something definitely a bit...
Is it me or is it
the...
Can you... Ah, okay.
That happens when you don't put the security on. But
it's
let's make
still
it stand
looking
up.
Strange.
Okay, let's see if we have some better signal again. Yeah.
Yeah, good. It's a bit better. Anyway, so now we see one of our first slides. Maybe you remember the multimodal telepresence system. So here's our implementation. On the operator side, we have the Kinect camera. We are using the other cameras as well, for example, InterReal Sense, 3D camera, or whatever. So there are different implementations existing. Communication channel is Wi-Fi, and our teleoperator is the Now robot. Hello, Now. By the way, he's just following the sound source, so this is why he's looking around all the time, especially when I'm talking. And we have different sensors attached to the Now robot, so for example, the cameras. We used an RGB stereoscopic camera from AliExpress or something like that, very cheap China stuff. Why did we use this special camera? The Now robot has already two cameras implemented, but the problem is they are vertically aligned. So as long as you are not a minion, you know, it doesn't make sense to use them. So this is why we just built our own 3D printed glasses, implemented the stereoscopic 3D camera in there so that we have a field of view which is somehow comparable to the human view. And the feedback channel, feedback data, what do we have? So it's the video data. And if you touch the Now's head, you will feel it on your own head. There is a connection between those tactile sensors and a vibration motor which is built into the headset. So if you touch the Now, you will feel it on the other side.
Okay, so let's have a look at the architecture then. We have some hardware, some software here. The most important hardware is, of course, the robot. But we also have an Intel IoT gateway, which is our central point of communication. Then we have the Raspberry Pi, which is on the backpack of the robot. So you can see it here. Well, here is a Raspberry Pi. And attached to this Raspberry Pi is the camera itself. Of course, we also have the laptop. And attached to the laptop, we have the Oculus Rift and the Kinect camera. And there are some software artifacts that we need for that. The first one would be the GStreamer application. So this GStreamer application just takes the camera data and sends it directly to the laptop where it is displayed within the Oculus Rift using a software we created and which is called Oculus Viewer. Then we have next the Kinect Steerer application. I think you cannot read that. We use the Kinect data that we get, transform it into the joint angles of the robot, And then we transfer it to the Intel IoT Gateway, where there is also a Docker container with the Now controller in it. And there we have the Python code that you just saw. And using the Now Key SDK, we can then control the robot remotely.
Yeah.
Okay, and most important of all, of course, the vibration controller. So this is directly attached to the Intel IoT Gateway, so it is always working,
yeah.
Which is crucial.
Okay, so after one day only using off-the-shelf hardware, we were able to control this robot with gestures. And this is a crazy thing because we are no robotic experts or something like that. We're just computer scientists, software developers. And within one day, this was possible to implement.
Not all of it.
Not. I said gesture control. Yeah. Okay. So, but what if you use such a system using it with real robots, so huge, large robots? So this is the Honda Asimo. So this is one of the more known robots which are available on the market. 60 units are existing. Unfortunately, you can't buy them. So only Honda is using this for showcases when the robot is going upstairs and downstairs and upstairs and downstairs. And this robot is able to walk those stairs. So it's prepared for those kind of stairs. If there is a little difference, then he can get some trouble. This looks like that, or like that. It hurts. It really hurts. But let's have a look to a robot which is prepared for such things. It's the Atlas robot from Boston Dynamics, by the way, bought by SoftBank Robotics a few months ago. And this robot, unfortunately, the video is still stopping. This robot is prepared to work on slippery surfaces, on ice, on snow, whatever you like. And this is done using special kind of sensors like a LiDAR and some AI machine learning stuff so that he will not fall down. And he is doing this in a really, really good way. Unfortunately, I don't know.
The video stops, unfortunately.
Yeah.
It continues.
Now it continues. Okay, now you can see it. He looks a little bit drunk. Maybe after somehow six beers or something like that. But he will hold its balance. And there is a new version or existing, which is based on wheels. And actually, this robot, the Atlas robot with wheels, is able to jump 1 meter height. This is amazing.
And there's a new video showing him backflip.
Yeah, right. And this is really scary. So if you have a look to YouTube, just watch this video, how this robot is doing a backflip. It's amazing.
But it's not always that amazing. So
yeah.
Let's have a look if it somehow
also if it's prepared to hold its balance all the time and solving tasks like carrying boxes, it can happen that he will fall down as well. So okay, so technology.
Yeah, let's have a look at the different cameras that we use. The first one is the Kinect One. So the Kinect One is from the year 2014. It was recently discontinued by Microsoft. But it is ideal for tracking skeleton data. So normally it can track skeleton data from each person in the room. So it can detect up to 6 persons in the same room. And as already said, we have 35 points that can be detected. And this is already done by the SDK. So you don't have to do this yourself. So you just have to employ the SDK. And then you get the data. We also have a visualizer for that, which is Martin is currently preparing. So here you can see the points. And
yep.
And now let's have a look at the visualizer. So if I stand in front of it.
One moment.
Does it work?
It should work.
It's live again. Sorry about that.
Mm-hmm.
Do you see?
I see you here, but not there. I don't know.
That's a pity.
Maybe you're not too far.
No. Ah, yeah. Now you see me. Okay, so here you see the skeleton points, and as I move around, all the joints move away. And this is a demo we did with JavaScript, so...
you look distorted.
Yeah, my legs are moving a bit.
Meshed up.
So, so this is what you see when it is in the so-called inferred state. So it's trying to guess where my feet are. It's not always that precise.
Looks like a ball of mud.
Yeah.
Okay, so I don't want to see this anymore. So let's have a look to another 3D camera.
Yeah.
What about the InterReal Sense?
The InterReal Sense camera. So this is from the year 2014, and it was built until 2016. This is the F200 and SR300. And these cameras, we also built them in, so you can directly use them within our demo as well. And this is what we in Germany call an egg-laying wool milk pig, so Eierlegende Wollmilchsau. So it can do pretty much everything. In English, you would
it
say...
It tries to do pretty much everything.
Yeah, so it's an all-rounder camera.
Yeah.
So what you can do is you can do different hand-tracking modes, so you can track 22 points on each hand, but also gestures on the hand. You can track the faces. We already saw that in the Terminator Vision
demo. Let's show that. I hope it works.
Yeah, so can here you can see it.
Yeah, okay. So
yeah, we see you, Martin. We see the contours of your face. So these are 78 points on the face, so the so-called landmarks. And when Martin is doing crazy things, you can see that here as well.
Yes.
And the nice thing is it looks a bit like an old Kraftwerk video. So... this is something that the RealSense API can do out of the box. But it can do even more. So it can do speech recognition, speech detection as well. You can identify faces and so on and so on. So there are much more things to do. At the moment, it's somehow a bit weird.
Like a ball of mud again.
Yeah,
this camera we actually used for our Terminator Vision. So, and we just used built-in SDK features, so API features. It was really easy to use. So there is a new camera existing. It was, on the Intel Developer Forum 2016, they published that they wanted to publish the Intel Euclid. And the Intel Euclid is a nice camera because it has the size of a USB stick, and everything you need to do 3D camera stuff is inside this USB-sized Euclid, and this is perfectly fine if you're doing your own IoT projects. Think of using the Microsoft Kinect camera, which has a weight of 1.5 kilograms, and Intel Euclid only weighs a few grams, and all the processing power, everything is in there. It also has a battery so that you can use it for your own projects then.
Yeah, okay. Now that we've talked about all the different 3D cameras, let's talk about the Oculus Rift itself, so the VR glasses that we use. Currently, we are still using the DK2. The main reason for that was the things we put on top of that. So we have this Maker Beam set here with the two USB cameras, and this was easier to apply to the old version because it has a an even surface and in the front, whereas the consumer version does not have that anymore. The consumer version is a bit more powerful, so it has a resolution of 2560 cross 1600 something pixels, and but you always have to divide that by two because each eye only gets half of the resolution. And here is a picture of the Oculus Rift. So this is what you normally see when you see such a such a screenshot from an Oculus Rift game. We have two different distortions in here. The first one is obvious to see, so the picture is not rectangular, but somehow barrel-shaped, and this is the so-called barrel distortion. So this is caused by the lenses which are included in the Oculus Rift, and these are so close to the eye that they introduce a distortion. And if you calculate that distortion in, you can remove the effects of the lenses, and then your picture looks something like this. The same is true for these edges. So here we see these hard edges up here. They are not really that hard. And again, this is a so-called chromatic aberration. And this is introduced by the lenses again. And if you calculate it in again, it is removed. And the nice thing about this SDK is that everything is done for you. So you just have to draw the 3D primitives and everything else is done by the SDK for you. Okay.
Okay, so now let's come to the challenges we had to solve with our project avatar.
The first challenge, of course, was bandwidth. So if you want to transmit large amounts of video data like we do, then you probably run into problems if you want to do that lag-free, because we don't want a lag of 100 milliseconds or 300 milliseconds or something like
so
that.
So 100 milliseconds lag means that's the same like if you have drunk five beers or something like that.
Yeah, and you don't really want to do this, so so you cannot do things like H.264 codecs because they introduce keyframes which need some time to build up, and therefore they introduce lag. So the only thing we can do is we can do something like MJPEG. So MJPEG just puts JPEG after JPEG after JPEG. So it still takes a lot of bandwidth because, yeah, we cannot just do some things like we could do with H.264. But they have lag-free a lag-free image, and therefore we introduced our own router board. So within the suitcase we have a router board with two networks. So they are sending out two H8202.11n networks, and with these networks we can then use one for just streaming the video signals and one for everything else. And that's how we came to a conclusion here.
Yeah, fields of application. Yeah, this is the DaVinci robot. And this is built since the year 2000. When we held this talk in Boston, there was a guy in the audience and he told us that his father was searched by this DaVinci robot. The reason behind that is he had some kind of cancer, and it was very difficult to remove the cancer because there was the dangerousness that it will spread. So what they are doing was they used the DaVinci surgical system because this is so precise, and now this is the barrier of scale again. This is so precise that they were able to remove the cancer without spreading it, because it's not just minimal invasive, it's just micro or whatever, you know, very, very precise. I think we can skip this because, yeah, here they are using active skeleton. Active means they have motors inside the skeleton. You are able to carry hundreds bottles of beer, I think. But here they are using it to remote control the Carpio robot. So, yeah. But let's go to distance learning.
Yeah, when it comes to distance learning, we have such a classical telepresence system. So you can then go to school without being physically attending school. And this is important for some people because, like Linton Beatty in this example here, some people have an immune deficiency and they cannot attend school because they would get very sick soon after that. And that's why they use such telepresence systems to have some kind of social life and to attend school again. So when we wrote this talk in 2016, there were 60 people in the world who were using such systems for distance learning.
Yeah.
Okay, and the last one is, of course, video conferences.
Just standard, yeah.
Here we're just using off-the-shelf hardware, so an iPad, we can just put that into a robotic arm, and then using FaceTime, we can then control this robot arm. So this was Kubi, a Kickstarter project, and you can then look around the conference room and not just have your limited field of view.
Right. Yeah, and that's it. No, we have the conclusion.
Yeah.
Yeah, Thomas, so let's talk about the conclusion. Because we have to skip those slides. This has to do with semi-autonomous stuff because Tele presents robotics, you cannot do it on the Mars or the Moon because the signal speed exceeds the time. So if you do telepresents on the Moon, for example, you have a signal loop of 2.6 seconds. Yeah, and for the Mars, it's between 8.5 minutes and up to 40, 45 minutes. It depends how far the Mars is away from the Earth. So then you are using semi-autonomous robots. In this case, the Mars rover Curiosity has routines like drill a hole there. So you using paths and everything, and it's semi-autonomously, because telepresence is not possible there. So now the conclusion, please.
Yeah, so yes, it is possible to build such a system, such a telepresence system within a few days. So the first prototype, again, was done in the first day. And it is really possible with off-the-shelf hardware to build such a system, even if you are not a robotics expert, with today's technology. But in this case, it's always like, what do you want? Do you really want a completely telepresent system where you control everything, or do you want a semi-autonomous system where you just give high-level instructions? And this would be the case for some things, like a disaster beyond all expectations, but for other things, semi-autonomous systems are more suited.
Yeah, that's it. Thanks for being with us, and we hope you had a great time.
Thank you.
Thank you.